I'm John Manalak. I am a junior here at Middlebury College.
I'm May. I use she, her pronouns. And I'm a junior here at Middlebury.
My name is Kaden LeMay. I am a first year at Middlebury.
I'm Max. I'm a junior. I use he, him pronouns.
Hi, my name is Celia Cadoy. I'm currently a freshman at Middlebury.
My name is Maksat. I'm a first year at Middlebury College. My pronouns are he, him.
My name is Zhang Hao, and I'm a first year here.
I'm Ni, senior, she, hers.
Okay, so hello. My name is Yuvraj Shah. I'm a freshman.
My name is Sadie Sadler. I am a freshman. I use she, her pronouns.
I'm Naomi. I'm a junior.
So where do you call home?
Montpelier, Vermont. I grew up in Barrie and also Woodbury, Vermont.
I was born in the Philippines, but I moved here when I was 4, so I don't really remember much.
I think I call home New Jersey and also France. I spent a lot of time there growing up.
Home for me would be Long Island, New York with my family. It was definitely a strange place to grow up in, being Asian, because it's a very like white conservative town.
It's definitely North Carolina now, although when I was growing up in North Carolina, I would always say my home is California because I wanted to be different and not be Southern.
So I say I call home down in Sheepshead Bay in Brooklyn because that's where I grew up most of my life, and I have a lot of memories associated there.
I would say two places. First is Albany, New York, specifically Delmar. It's a suburb in New York. And then the second place, which is where I was born, is in Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam.
I call two places home. One is in Southern China. I think it's called Foshan. And my second place that I call home is Brooklyn, New York City.
I call New York City home.
So home for me is Nairobi in Kenya, which is actually a metropolitan city in Africa, which gets a lot of people's eyes up because obviously I'm of Indian heritage. But what people don't actually know about Indians in East Africa is we are a very historic demographic. We've been there for about 200 years now. We don't call anywhere on the Asian continent home. In fact, we don't even know where in India exactly we're from.
I guess I would call Los Angeles my home, but I was originally born in New York City, so that always has like a special place in my heart for me.
What is your favorite comfort food?
For me, my two comfort foods are either lumpia or sapin-sapin, which is a Filipino dessert. Memories of me like growing up and being able to eat Filipino food, because that was like a big treat for us because we didn't usually get any. It reminds me of like family reunions and just fun family events.
Just cinnamon and sugar on toast with a lot of butter. My mom used to call it comfort toast, and I guess I just associate it with being homesick or my mental health days from school.
I was always obsessed, this is like such a random thing, but I was always obsessed with seared salmon with Japanese mayonnaise. There's this revolving sushi bar in Little Tokyo in LA called Kura, and that was just my favorite thing there. I guess that's the place I used to go with my dad.
My favorite comfort food is probably, this is really difficult to say, I would say rice with any kind of meat. Just like, I could, like, I remember being at home, like, you just get some leftovers, heat it up, eat with rice. For me, that was my comfort food because I would just eat that whenever I was hungry.
My grandma, she is third generation American. One of the coolest Japanese American things that she makes is onigiri, but it's a rice, seaweed, and hot dogs. And she would always make those when we'd ever go hiking or going up to Yosemite. As I've gotten older, I've appreciated the unabashed Japanese-Americanness of it.
Yeah, my comfort food is probably this dish called samsa. It's a Central Asian dish. It has like meat and like potatoes and onions. It's like an outer kind of shell with like a doughy crust. I grew up eating a lot of that among other Central Asian cuisine too.
Yeah, my favorite comfort food is this Chinese dish that's like tomato egg. Shihoshichajidan. And it's like in any form, like either if it's like soup with like noodles or if it's just like the dish with like rice or something. You know, like the Chinese tradition where on your birthday you have to eat noodles for longevity and like eggs. So every year when I have noodles and eggs, my mom always makes me like tomato egg soup with noodles. I don't know, it's very nostalgic food for me. Whenever I go visit my family in China, like they're always like, oh, that's like, oh, Xiao Mimi, like that's like her favorite.
My favorite comfort food is this noodle dish called hủ tiếu. It's just a Vietnamese noodle soup, much less popular than pho here, but very popular in Vietnam. I guess it's like walking to the market and getting a bowl of hủ tiếu. I would usually eat it for breakfast, but you can really eat it anytime during the day. I said like morning or night for dinner.
I really like chips and popcorn, but for the sake of this interview, my favorite Chinese comfort food is this spicy thing called wei long. It's like really transparent noodles. Back at home, I lived in a really little town, and every time I go out, I would just buy it.
My comfort food is really just any type of Chinese food. Dumplings, noodles, rice rolls. I always just feel at home if I go to a Chinese restaurant, especially in Chinatown in New York City, and have some Chinese food there. I feel especially connected to my culture.
My favorite comfort food is a drink, actually. It's chai, which is a South Asian tea drink. But it's Kenyan chai for me. I drink it, I think, 6 times a day. If you ever see me in the dining hall, I always have it in my bag with like masala, which is the spice we put inside, which my grandmother makes and sends to me every month or so. Kenyan chai is a lot more milky. It's a lot more spicy than it would be in India. And I really like drinking chai because for me, it's like a drink of my own identity. It's an Indian drink that has so much Kenyan influence in it.
Can you describe how being Asian influenced the way you grew up or like your outlook on the world? I mean, probably the biggest thing to just note is that I am adopted from China by a single white woman. My immediate family is just myself, Chinese, and then my mom, who is white. I think from my childhood, she has not hidden the fact that we are two different races and that we will face discrimination or just looks from people because of that. And that has happened since childhood. People just trying to figure out, like, am I really her child or how am I related to my mom?
As a transracial adoptee, growing up in such a white state, being Asian and thinking I was white definitely affected my activism today, trying to create more affinity spaces, trying to be the role model that I never had growing up, right? Because no one looked at like me, trying to lead by example.
I would say for sure, being Asian has definitely played a large role in my outlook on the world. I grew up like Asian American. I'd say I had a pretty diverse elementary school. There was like a Russian program there, which was pretty interesting because I'm from Kyrgyzstan, so I grew up like in a Russian household, essentially, like hearing Russian, but also hearing Kyrgyz too. So it was kind of nice to see their like Russian alphabet around. It was also weird because it's like I'm Asian, like people don't look at me and think I'm Russian. It was kind of weird like talking to some of them and then they're like, what the hell, like you speak Russian? Like it doesn't make any sense.
It definitely has, but it wasn't something I always thought about until really I moved to North Carolina. I was just made more aware that I was different. In Greensboro, where I grew up, the population has a very, very small Asian population. And like whenever civil rights or anything around race came up, Asians weren't mentioned ever. And that made me question where I fit into all of it.
I was ashamed of being Asian for a good part of my life. Mostly because I went to a all-girls Catholic private school and I was like one of the few non-white people there, and it just made me feel like ostracized and like kind of ashamed of being different. Being Asian just really put me on the sidelines at school, at least in my own head.
I never really saw myself as Asian because it was such an alien continent to me. The concept of India, for example, was such an alien place. I've never been till today. I don't really have any plans to go in the future. I never identified as Asian until coming to the United States, where Asian is an identity here.
You really have to navigate in a world where you're feeling almost like lonely almost all the time. Especially this Asian identity intersecting with my American queer neurodivergent identities, that has made it 10 times harder for me to find friends.
even when I would also like have fun, there was always like a strong amount of guilt behind it, because I always felt like, oh, there's something else I could be doing that's better. Or like my parents would always be like, okay, like because you did this, now you have to do all of this, like all these chores back at home, like you gotta like look after your siblings, stuff like that. That's just kind of how my mentality was, like without much question. I was like, okay, like that's just how life works. When I was in high school, adjusting to the fact that that's not how other people live was pretty shocking to me, I'd say.
My mom always made sure that I stayed connected to my Chinese culture. She put me in Chinese language schools since I was like six. We always celebrated Chinese New Year. For a while, she deliberately hired a Chinese nanny so that I could try to learn some language and some more about the culture. I don't know how well that really worked out.
Yeah, it definitely influenced the way I grew up. Being half, you're in a very particular place where like you kind of have your foot in both worlds, and I think being in such a white town kind of made me embrace my Asian identity like a lot more than I would have. You know, like the white people are like, oh, you're Asian, but the Asian people are like, oh, you're white. But I don't know, my group of like Chinese friends that I like grew up with, like we had been friends together since we were like 6-7 years old, so they kind of just always accepted me for who I was. But like I definitely felt that when I was not with them, when I was like in other like classroom settings or something, I definitely embraced that side of me a lot more, and like I felt proud of it, even though people would like definitely microaggressing me every day, you know, asking me just like out of pocket questions like about where I come from. I don't know, I kind of, it makes me proud of who I am, being like kind of special, you know, in a very white space.
I'm proud of my culture. I really do love a lot of things about Japanese culture. I think it's really innovative. Like growing up, I would watch these two cartoons, anime. One of them was Anpanman, which is about this superhero whose head is literally made out of bread and filled with red bean. And all of his like superhero friends also had heads that were made out of bread, and he would go around saving people. And if they needed help, he would literally take a piece of his own head and like feed it to them. And his father was the baker, so his father would bake him a new head. So that's, it sounds so bizarre, but it was so cool. Like I don't feel like that's something you can find anywhere else. It's just so unique.
Has there ever been a time where you felt especially aware of your Asian identity?
When I first moved to the US, which was when I was in fourth grade, knowing that like I was different, or like studying like history and like the Vietnam War and all that, I feel like I was like more heightened of my identity during that part of life. After middle school and into high school, I've grown more distant with my Asian identity.
In my first job in high school, we all had these little name tags, and mine said May, and it was obviously like a foreign name or something that like people couldn't pronounce. And when I introduced myself, people looked at my name tag and said, oh, like ni hao, and like, and that really was a shocking moment for me.
I guess times when I feel most aware of my Asian identity, maybe like Japanese New Year or something, I'll always go with my dad to Little Tokyo on New Year's Day, and they'll always have like mochi pounding, and we'll go to like the temple and we'll make our like prayer for the new year, and I'll pull like a fortune. So it's like those kinds of traditions, I guess.
Like basically in short, I had to get surgery when I was around 6 years old, and at the hospital right before the surgery, the nurse wouldn't allow me to be operated on. She didn't really believe that I was my mother's daughter. And the nurse was like, I'm gonna need proof of your relationship. So then my mom had to get my birth certificate. And it was a whole mess, but it was just like one of those moments where me being Asian and then her being white, it actually caused a problem.
Also negative, because I love being a Debbie Downer. There were times where my mom would like pack his lunch for school, and it would be like leftovers from dinner we had, and it would be like adobo or something like that. And if you don't know, adobo has like very strong like vinegar smell, so you could smell it when you brought it in. My mom would pack it for me, and I'd just be like super embarrassed, I guess, because I knew everyone could smell it, and like it's not a normal food, it's not mac and cheese or like a regular hot lunch. It just like made me feel like I was like standing out.
I think where it affected me the most was in middle school, because one of the ways that I try to fit in was to capitalize on my Asianness. That just means like I would make like offensive jokes or whatever, just to like be the goofy Asian friend who would make Asian jokes and make all the white people comfortable. Later in high school, there were more Asian American students and also a lot of Chinese international students. And that was a really awesome way that I felt like I finally had a community that I could bond over and I didn't have to make fun of the Asianness to fit in.
Yeah, I mean, I think both positive and negative, because, you know, when you have like your celebrations, like our Chinese school would throw like big end of the year celebrations or Chinese New Year celebrations, like it feels like you have a community, and I haven't felt that in a really long time, ever since COVID. That would be definitely a super positive experience, is getting to just kind of like celebrate your culture with like all the people that like share that experience with you. They're all far away from home as well, you know, it's like the parents, like the immigrant parents and all like the first gen kids, like we're all like getting together, like eating really big meals, like face painting, like we do like traditional dance, like ribbon dancing. Those moments made me like feel particularly happy and like aware of my Asianness, but like in a very good way.
Other people who are American born did not have the same problem as me because they knew English and I didn't know that much English. They just looked at me so differently because I was from China. I just felt like I had to hide this immigrant identity. I couldn't show that I did not know English. I had to show that I just spoke English perfectly and I was born here.
Do you feel like that's changed over time at all?
Yeah, I have. Because coming to Middlebury, I just felt my culture was more welcomed, and there are literally international Chinese students here. They interact in a way that's like not ashamed of where they come from. So I don't feel like I need to hide my immigrant identity here.
There was one moment on the subway, a guy just came up to me and was like, "Are you Asian?" And I was like, I just froze. I had no idea what to say, because it's like, are you gonna attack me if I say yes? Like, can I even say yes? Because like, obviously, like what? So then, I mean, I think I just was like, yeah. And then the guy said like, "You're beautiful," and then walked away. So it was all fine. But that was just weird, and a moment of like panic, and like in this, like during that time period, like I was like a targeted group in America, and I felt unsafe, and like that's when like I really felt being Asian.
My middle school was predominantly like East Asian, and there was like a strong kind of cultural around like prioritizing like your academics, like only like focusing on like grades, assorting your own value, your own worth onto whatever like your GPA is or your overall average, whatever that means. It was like really toxic. Like a lot of my friends were like that. Like they were kind of more like competitors than they were friends, to be honest. Growing up like with them, like just those 3 years in middle school was like super, felt very like heightened. Like, oh, like yeah, I'm Asian. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. Like I'm supposed to be good at all these things. And if I'm not, then it's like I'm not like really living up to what I'm supposed to be. In sixth grade, I failed my math state exam. I got put into this really like the lowest class kind of in my high school for math. I was always reminded like, oh yeah, I failed. Like my friends kind of like would sometimes poke fun at me because I wasn't at their level. My race there was like super focused in like every single day of school. Like, oh yeah, I'm Asian, but I failed my math exam. Always being repeated to you. So that was pretty tough.
Has there ever been a time where you felt not Asian enough?
Okay, not Asian enough. okay, this Matt. I'm gonna say that's the first one. I was like okay-ish at math. I mean, there is a very big stereotype for like all Asians are good at math. The question is why. For me particularly, I would say the big question I asked myself in the school was like, why am I not understanding this? Now that I recognize it, it was because in middle school, I think when I was learning pre-algebra or something, I did not have glasses then. I just realized now that, you know, maybe the reason why I hate math right now is because my fundamentals got screwed up in middle school when I just couldn't see the board for a year. In terms of like culture, so I can understand Tagalog really well. I can translate it to English, but I cannot fluently speak it. I can say the words, but I can't just like consciously bring up the language. And for me, that's actually one of my major fears in going back to the Philippines, if I go back there. Not necessarily not Asian enough, but for me, it's like I'm not like Filipino and I don't know, yeah.
Definitely in middle school, I didn't feel Asian enough because my last name is Niaz. At least to some of my middle school friends, like it sounded Hispanic almost. I felt like, at least in middle school, that I was always trying to show my, like prove my worth, like prove my Asianness. Like they would just kind of like look at my name like, what the, like it doesn't make any sense. Like, or like even my country, like Kyrgyzstan, like no one really knows where that is or even like associates it with Asian. Like
being half French and half Filipino really influenced that. To me, I always did not look Asian enough because there's like the stereotype of like what Asians look like, and the Philippines is surprisingly not on many people's radars. So I just didn't feel like I was Asian.
I'm mixed race. My dad is an Asian. And so I was always raised in an Asian household, but there's just so many layers that makes me feel further away from that part of myself. My mom is fourth generation, I'm fifth generation. And so we are just a long way away from our ancestry. So I don't share a lot of the immigrant experience of a lot of Asian Americans. Being mixed race, that's also another layer of just, it's only half of me. And then on top of that, which identity do I choose, or do I identify more with the Chinese or the Japanese? A lot of my life has felt really divided and uncertain to what I have claim to.
Yeah, for sure. And I had this girl once, and she was like talking to me, and she was like, because my last name is Clark instead of my mom's last name. And I remember her saying like, oh, you don't know what it's like to be truly Asian. You're gonna have like a white last name when you apply to college, so you're gonna have no trouble getting into college, and we're gonna have so much trouble. And she's like, you don't know what it's like to be truly Asian. And like, she would always say like really like mean things to me, like related to that line, because she was like fully Korean. So she would just like always say things to make herself feel, I guess, better than me. And you know, like I've had people like call me like a mutt or like mongrel or like, I shouldn't be alive because mixed race is unnatural or like some shit like that, you know. Like I've definitely experienced those moments where I felt like not Asian enough or like not enough of something. But you are what you feel you are, you know. I don't think that that has to be something that like other people define for you. So I think I've definitely accepted myself a lot more, and I'm very like, I'm much more comfortable with who I am now.
I'm also like half white, half Asian, mm-hmm. And people like to...
This is everyone here.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. They like to, people will be like, oh, you're Wajian. And they say like, yeah. It's a weird,
yeah.
Like a bad
yeah,
thing.
Yeah.
It's a very odd thing to me. Like, yeah. Why do you have to label me like that? Like, I am who I am.
Yeah, and I feel like people always have assumptions about you being like a Wajian, like my group of friends would be like, oh, she's the Asian one, so she's like the stupid one out of us because I'm half white, and like the rest of them are like fully Asian, even though like there's not really that much of a difference between us. Like we're all intelligent human beings. Like I don't know.
Sometimes I'm jealous because Asian international kids, like they have like their big group of friends, or even like with like C's, like they're all very tight knit, and like I'm friends with them like individually, but I just like don't really have like a big Asian friend group at Middlebury. And maybe it's like part of like my like fault because like I didn't like put in enough effort. But I do like have like very like close connection with different like Asian friends. But because of that, like sometimes I think that like maybe like I'm not Asian enough, and like maybe I didn't put enough like effort to like go outside of my like regular like routine.
Yeah, especially around international Chinese students, because I'm like a 0.5 or like 1.5 generation, because I emigrated here when I was 9. I know half Chinese and half English, and I was influenced by both cultures, and sometimes I just feel like my Chinese will never catch up to them, and they will make fun of my American side. There's just a big cultural difference between the Chinese culture and the American culture.
Both at MID and outside of MID, just people assuming that I know how to speak Chinese or that both my parents are Asian, like just moments like that just make me aware, like, oh yeah, I am Chinese, but like no, I don't have two Chinese parents and I can't speak Chinese.
Definitely. There are so many cases. I think particularly growing up as half Asian and half white, I had a lot of experiences where people, even like jokingly, like my friends would say, they're like, oh, Celia, you're not Asian enough, you're like whitewashed because you're only half. And I know that was like very hurtful to me deeply, especially because I feel like I don't like physically
look white. I like feel like I present as Asian. So that's something that's, I don't know, that's just very hurtful when people say things like that. One person one time was grilling me. I don't know why he was interrogating me, but he was interrogating me and he's like, oh, you're half white, Celia. So you're half colonizer. And I was like, I don't know. It was just an odd thing to tell someone.
A lot of people like to set these metrics for being Asian enough. So within the South Asian community, the first thing is always Hindi, which baffles me because apart from North India, nowhere else in South Asia technically speaks Hindi. And I think that's a really big thing that needs to be talked about, where these metrics of culture and gatekeeping. If you don't meet XYZ, you're not Indian enough, you're not brown enough, you're not South Asian enough. And those are the times I think I've felt not Asian enough at Middlebury. I do really hate the word whitewashed. I think a lot of the times it comes from their own insecurities and they like to sort of make themselves seem more cultured by taking it out against you. And also, I feel like whenever Asians call each other whitewashed, all we are doing is playing into white supremacy because we're trying to distance ourselves or trying to put down other Asians because of their proximity to Western culture. I feel like a lot of the things we do, we don't realize. We think we're protecting our culture. You know, we think by shaming him into not speaking Hindi, by shaming her that she doesn't know this Bollywood film, we're gonna make her go watch that film. We're gonna make him go study Hindi. In my opinion, all it does is it affirms white supremacy. It affirms the idea that whiteness is the norm, that to be normal, you first have to be white before anything else. And I think that's a big thing a lot of Asians at Middlebury really need to uncover, which is a lot of the prejudices they hold come from white supremacy, not from Asian culture at all. In fact, it's the very opposite from Asian culture.
And what does being Asian mean to you?
That's a really good question. I think I still need to figure that out.
I feel like I'm still trying to figure that out because, surprisingly, being Asian was the part of my identity that took the longest to come to terms with, which is funny because the other parts of my identity are being gay and gender fluid, which kind of ironic. Being Filipino, to me, is happiness, it's family. So recently, I got this tattoo of a sun, and it's just to like symbolize like that it's okay to be proud of who you are and not everybody might understand your culture. It's who you are, it's like your people, and it's something to be proud of.
Well, one, I was born in what people consider the region as Asia, the Asian region. Like, it's really interesting because I remember before they did not include the South East Asian countries, they had it kind of labeled differently. I remember before, like, now, I think now they have like Asian or Pacific Islander, but before it was Asian and then you had Pacific Islander. So I was like, wait, technically I'm a Pacific Islander, but all this whole time I view myself as Asian. So which one am I?
I feel like for me to be Asian, specifically to be a Kenyan Asian, to me means resilience. It means resistance. You know, my great-great-grandparents were forcibly brought to East Africa. The British brought them to build railways. But they made a life for themselves. They built a thriving community. In the 1970s, there were 3 million of us living in East Africa. And to me, being a Kenyan Asian, why I'm so proud about being from Kenya, I know why I'll always wear this bracelet, why I'll always, first of all, affirm that I am from Kenya before anything else about myself, is because my ancestors went through so much to establish a community in East Africa, to affirm themselves, to learn the Swahili language, to get citizenship papers in East Africa, but at the same time keep themselves connected to Gujarati, to wearing Indian clothes at home, to cooking Indian food. And I think that's just the concept of resilience. I think Asian people and people of color in general are so resilient because against all the odds they've been dealt, they still somehow come up on top. They still somehow have connections to their culture. They still somehow are proud of who they are. So to me, being Asian, I think, is the concept of resilience, the concept of like really affirming yourself outside of the white binary ideas of identity. And I think that's a really big part of it.
For me, Asian is just, I don't know, it's my family. The connection and the community that my family has with one another. I am really, really thankful and grateful that my family is really tight-knit and really big. We have family, well, before COVID, we had pretty frequent family gatherings, and there's so many people I don't know, but there's so much love despite that, and that is something that I really love that I have access to.
I guess, I don't know, being Asian to me is like, it's very special, and I think it means a lot of things. I think it means that you do come from a place where like your parents have like worked very hard, and like I feel like a lot of people have assumptions about you that you're like, what's the word, model minority, you know, like people have like those assumptions about you, like you're very hard worker, blah, blah, blah. But I think it also like, it runs a lot deeper than that. Like I think Asian people like love hard even though it's not on the outside, if that makes sense. You know, like they love through their actions and they love through like their food. Like, the love that you have for your family is very fierce, I think, and, like, the importance of family and, like, being with those that you love and, like, always looking out for, like, the people, like, in your small circle, I think is very, like, a prominent thing in Asian culture, even if they don't always vocalize that, I guess.
Having a lot of family members and relatives who will always ask how you're doing and will give you red envelopes and delicious food and big family gatherings, and also really good smell whenever you are in family gatherings.
Have you ever felt targeted by the stereotype that all Asians are the same?
Oh, 100. All the time, definitely. A big thing that I sort of was shocked by is the concept of Asian, because you're grouping people from the Middle East to South Asia to Japan together. These people have very little in common. Religious differences, cultural differences, linguistic differences. But here in the US, because they're from this continent, it's convenient to group us together. What I'm sort of really interested in is making sure people at Middlebury are really aware of how diverse the continent is. It is the most diverse continent on our planet. And I think that really is important to understand how even within Asia, there's so many distinctions that it really affects and makes your outlook on the world very different. I feel like at Middlebury, I think people group us into this monolith of very upper class people who have just come from Asia as international students and are just gonna, you know, live at Middlebury in this very upper class bubble and graduate. And it's been a very negative experience because it really deaffirms that a lot, in fact, most Asians within most of the world are much lower class than would be the average Westerner. And what it does is it really deaffirms those of us who are here on significant financial aid, who are here working 20 hours a week, we're here, you know, first in our families to go to college. It really deaffirms the socioeconomic gap within the Asian community at Middlebury.
I think people might have the stereotype that we as like BIPOC or Asians just like hang around people of that we view are similar to us because we don't want to hang out with other people, right? But for me, it's just like kind of finding that common people who share a common background, and that's why I just like hope that there's not like that stereotype that we're like, oh, we're not hanging out with you because you're like this certain like race or skin color, or because you're not like Asian.
Yes, but kind of in a maybe unconventional way. My identity doesn't fit with what people expect. Because I am fifth generation American, I don't share a lot of the experiences of having a mom who doesn't speak English, or growing up in a bilingual household, or visiting a homeland. The closest I get is I visit California. There is a much greater distance between me and that like ancestral culture. And then there's also like the mixed identity on top of that of my mom is the only Asian parent that I had. Yeah, and also relationships with like parents. I come from like a non-conventional family. So that's another way that I feel like I don't necessarily fit into all the things that people relate to each other with.
No, not very often. I mean, there are like the classic experiences when like someone would mix up your name with another Asian kid and I would get like really annoyed. But like it doesn't happen like so often, and like they're very like aware, like I let them know like right away.
I've definitely had people confuse me for other Asians on campus.
Okay, I don't know if like targeted like maliciously would be the right word, yeah. But I have like absolutely been mixed up with other like halfy people or just like fully Asian people, like, and I don't think it was like a malicious thing that they were targeting me to be like, oh, you're all the same, but like I've definitely had people and professors like call me other names. Like, do you know Franny Newman? I don't even know her. I get mixed up with her so much.
We don't look anything alike,
and I'm sure she gets mixed up with me as well, like, but I've like actually never spoken to her before. And like people will be like, oh, Franny, or like my friends will be like, oh, I thought I saw Franny the other day, and then you turned around. And then I was like, oh, okay, like, cool. I'm like, what?
I mean, I guess there's this other assumption about Asian women specifically, that Asian women are just kind of passive and submissive, and so I feel like there's an interesting kind of power dynamic whenever I walk around campus at night especially, because I tend to just set a path and continue on that path no matter what, and no matter if I bump into anyone or anything like that. So I feel like people don't expect that, one, and then two, are extremely reactive to that, just because somehow my presence is larger than what they would expect of an Asian woman.
Microaggressions. Around my second day, I got like hate crimed. Basically, I was like walking like through some tour, like through First and Mid, like around the AC, and like some car like drives by and like yells out like some Asian slur. And I was like, what? And I was like, no way. And that was kind of like, it was pretty shocking for me to like experience something like that. But I was kind of like, damn, like that sucks. Like I was pretty excited, pretty hyped that day, just cause like just woke up, like second day at college ever. I didn't really know how to feel. I honestly wished that car would have stopped so I could have a conversation or with the person or something. But it did put somewhat of a downer on my mood, cause it's kind of hard to feel welcomed at a PWI as a person. POC.
I did have one experience where I was talking to a member of staff at Middlebury. I was interviewing them for a project, and it was, I don't remember what they were talking about. They were talking about something about minority groups, and they're like, oh, you know, like Asian people, and they pointed at me, and I was like, oh, okay. Like, I didn't realize my Asianness was so apparent to you. And he like went on, he was talking about something. He's like, oh, I always like to use this like metaphor. I forgot which kind of Japanese martial art it was, but he's like, I always use, like, I do this martial art. He's like, oh, I don't want to white-splain to you, like, what kind of Asian are you? And I was like, oh. There's also that assumption that I know more about Japanese culture than I do. Like, sometimes my friends will make fun of me. They're like, oh my god, like, how can you have not watched anime, Celia? That's your culture. And I know they're teasing me, but I'm like, I don't watch anime. Like, just because I'm Japanese doesn't imply that that's something I would do.
One thing that, like, I have picked up on, but maybe just like from being in college and not so much like Middlebury, is like the fetishization of Asian women. And it's like never great to like, and I've experienced this, like I hooked up with this guy and then like later I find out like, oh, he has like an Asian fetish, and then like it makes me like feels like very like icky. And like I don't know. And it's also hard because like the classic like beauty standard or type at Middlebury would just be like athletic, blonde, and like skinny, and I feel like the classic like bitty. So that, I feel like that has made me like more aware of like my Asian identity when it comes to hookup culture and just like that aspect of life.
Sometimes people will look at me and just speak Chinese, looking at me and just being like, I guess unconsciously being like, oh, he must be Chinese, that kind of thing. That's just really normal because I do that too. It's my way of like, I guess my schema, like how I take in information and remembering them.
I remember this peculiar conversation I once had with a professor who was talking about how, you know, the Prime Minister of Britain right now is an Indian, Rishi Sunak. And he was like, oh, you know, it's so beautiful to see modern Britain, urban Britain has elected an Indian after everything that happened with colonization and racism in the 80s, etc. And, you know, I was just trying to have a conversation with him, so I put my hand up and I was like, well, you know, Rishi Sunak is a disgusting person. You know, Rishi Sunak is not the representation people want. What he is a tool of the white upper class. They've put him there to distract everyone else from systemic racism within society. So I was telling this professor all these things, and you know, he just refused to understand, refused to listen, and I think he was masked by the fact that there is a brown man in the British government. This refusal to listen to those of us who have been through the experiences, coming from professors, coming from fellow people within the Asian community, and just the community in general, I think is a big problem. I think we have to remember, if someone has a story, it's because they've been through it. And so you should really listen to them because they know what they're talking about more than a textbook would, more than a website would. So that's a really important thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What are some culture shocks you've experienced in Mid?
I would say the biggest culture shock for me was, I feel like in LA, it was a lot more like mixed, like you would make friends with people from like all backgrounds, all socioeconomic backgrounds, all ethnic backgrounds. And then I felt like when I came here, it felt a little bit more segregated. Like I remember just seeing like tables where it was just like, oh, POC are sitting at one table, and then another table is just like all white people. And that was just a little jarring to me.
Definitely in terms of economic status, especially coming from a public high school that was had very little resources. Coming here to MID was like, wow, like there's so many resources available to students. And also just seeing how Middlebury students just go travel internationally over breaks. That was something that was very shocking to me, just growing up in rural Vermont, where you don't leave your little bubble.
So I have two very conflicting culture shocks, I think, because where I grew up in New Jersey, it was a very diverse, tons of like different people. There are like restaurants for like every different type of cuisine you could think of. And coming to Middlebury, you could just like feel the really intense like whiteness of like the campus. So that was like a big shock to me. But at the same time, seeing like international people and just like diverse groups of people, like BIPOC communities, and even just like Asian people on campus and like them having their own clubs, that was also a big shock to me because I did not have that in high school growing up. So in one way it was very like, wow, like people like can actually like come together based on like their identities and like have stuff in common. But at the same time I was like, wow, this is very white, and that caught me off guard.
When people talked about this school and Vermont in general being a majority white population, I did not realize what that meant. I came from LA and there was like one white person in my school. I always tell people when I'm here, I'm like, yeah, I come from a very, very diverse kind of area. And I remember my school, like we had people from literally every continent in the world except Antarctica. But for me, that was the norm. It was like, wow, you're from this place. It wasn't like their ethnicity or race that I noticed, but just like the qualities or character of who they were. While here, I would say it was the first thing I noticed, just because I just had not seen that many. I'm in Filipino town and I don't go outside of Filipino town, and I have like, I probably had like one or two white friends max, and I probably only knew three or four white people in our school. And so for me, that was really kind of like, whoa, there is so much more white people in the world than I realize.
Honestly, I don't think so, because I think Middlebury like is very similar to my hometown in that it's like very white cotton, not necessarily like rich, like I think they're like richer here than in my hometown, but like definitely white and like at times like arrogant or ignorant like people that like don't really know much about a person like me, I guess, or like where I come from. But I think I've like been very like desensitized to that because I experience a lot of that from my hometown, if not more in my hometown than here.
Okay. How do you feel about the dining hall's take on Asian food?
Oh!
or just like Asian food at MID, like off campus, on campus.
Yummy. You know, actually, Yogurt City's dumplings eat so hard.
Oh,
that's like the only thing, cause like they like, cause Bing Bing is like my mom, bro. Like I don't know, like her dumplings like that they make remind me of my mom's dumplings. You know, like have you ever had the dumplings from like Rice or from Magic Wok? The skin on
the
it is like
Magic Wok's terrible.
They're like the Magic Wok and Rice are the same. Like the skin is literally like a centimeter thick. It's like, oh, it's ridiculous. And like, I love how Proc takes like Tyson chicken nuggets and throws some sauce, like some soy-based sauce on it, and it's like general sort of chicken. Like, or like, have you seen like the mapo tofu? It's just like, I'm like, what is this, bro? But I mean, food is food, I guess. Or like crunchy rice. Yeah, so good.
I would say it is definitely lacking, but also, just like Asian goods in this area is lacking overall. I think you have to go to Burlington to get them. I mean, and for the dining hall, they do try with the Fajian food. It's like the, you know, when they make the chicken balls that they call I already forgot the name.
I mean, like, I think I'm pretty, like, lenient in criticizing that because, like, it's a college dining hall. Like, what can we really expect from them? Like, they have to stay within a budget. They have to still cater to, like, so many masses of people. So, like, doing this specific, like, complex Asian dish, like, I'm not expecting them to do that, honestly. The Asian food they do have, I mean, I don't know. In terms of its taste, it's tasty. It's fine. Is it authentic? No.
I think a really, really shocking thing. I think it's so peculiar to me how South Asians are the fifth largest demographic on campus. We're a lot of us. We're about 100 and something. There is rarely any Indian food. Twice a semester, Atwater will serve it at lunch, which I think is so peculiar to me. Why do we have Greek food every other week and never have South Asian food? Like, I'm sure the Greek students love it, but we need a lot more South Asian food as well. I think that's just so peculiar to me that it's not there, considering it's such a huge thing in the US, I think, to go and get Indian takeout and stuff. It's not difficult to cook. People think it's difficult to cook. People think Asian food is difficult to cook. It's really simple to cook at the end of the day. That's something that's been a really big problem. I think dining services need to do a drastic overhaul of the South Asian food they offer because it is, I think, the most underrepresented cuisine in relation to the number of us who are on campus. Yeah, and actually, if you include this in the documentary, I think shout out to Tindia. We love Tindia. Tindia is such, they're really nice. The staff are incredible. They work with Sasa all the time. They cater all our events. They're an incredible restaurant. We're really glad to have them in town. That's the one thing that we have, at least, that's really good. Yeah.
Do you feel like your culture is respected, celebrated,
and
seen at
MID? Definitely not. I don't think it's celebrated or seen pretty much anywhere because it's a pretty small country. I know in the Russian department, there's some study abroad programs for people learning Russian to go to Kyrgyzstan, which is pretty cool. But like, that's not really, I wouldn't say that's particularly like kind of celebrating the culture or tradition per se. That's more of just like me finding the positives.
I think when we're talking about the transracial adoptee community, no. I think when we're talking about the Chinese community, yes. So I think there are different subgroups that are highlighted more than others.
Someone actually recently brought up, they were talking about the lack of representation with Asian American classes specifically. Like they'll have classes about Japan, they'll have classes about China, they'll have classes about other parts of Asia, but they won't necessarily have anything about like Asian American. So I think that would be something that I would appreciate seeing at MID.
For my mixed identity, I think like, and I've been an active part of this, but we've definitely been trying to do a lot more for mixed students and creating more of a community with that at Mixed at MID. And so that's been an active effort and hopefully things can start moving forward with that. The Japanese side, I've always felt has been a bit underrepresented when it comes to Japanese American history. For my grandma's generation, growing up in the US during World War II and with the internment camps, I feel like that's something that still is like criminally underrepresented in a lot of history and a lot of just common knowledge about American history. It's something that always shocks me that people don't know because it was such an important part of my family history and my grandma's story. A lot of the narrative has been focused on more recent Asian Americans, and like that's awesome and really important, but I do feel like that there is more work to be done when it comes to Asian Americans like my family who have been in this country for a bit longer, and I think that there's some important history that just is being overlooked right now.
I feel like for the past 2 years that I've been here, because Chinese New Year, like freshman year, I'm trying to remember, were we here or not? I don't really remember. That was a blur. I kind of blocked that all out.
Yeah, I think we were away, because I had some friends who were stuck here.
Yeah, because I feel like I celebrated Chinese New Year with my family freshman year. Yeah, but like through the past 2 years, like Chinese New Year, I feel like kind of came and went, mm-hmm. and I like didn't even realize, like I knew that it was happening, but I didn't feel like it was happening. And I didn't really know about like any celebrations or anything. Like I like made myself some like food on Chinese New Year, but that was really it. And it's kind of sad because like our Chinese New Year celebrations growing up were always like a lot of fun. I haven't really experienced much of that here, but I don't feel like disrespected, but I don't feel celebrated either.
I feel like my Asian culture, yes, but like if you get like more niche, like my Vietnamese roots. It's great that we have VSA, but it is a very small club and like they do the best they can, but I feel like in some ways like it could be more like supported by like maybe other orgs or like the community as a whole.
In terms of academics or even like faculty, I don't know, maybe not so much. Again, there's only so many classes that a college like this size could offer. And I mean, there are like humanities classes that like are about Asian topics, but I guess I do wish there was more of that.
I definitely think so. I think that a really good thing is that people are respectful of culture at Middlebury. Thankfully, I think it's because we do have a very liberal bubble here. And again, it's Vermont. So I think we are a lot safer at projecting our culture than we would be in other parts of the United States. You know, SASA, which I'm part of, we've been doing a lot of events recently. We've been really trying to push ourselves out there. And I think we've had very good reception. So we had our Shadi last weekend, which we think people were very respectful about it. We have Holi coming up in a few hours, which we're expecting a lot of people to come for. And what we've noticed is there's been a lot of good outlook at the culture that the South Asian community is trying to put out there. We hope that we can do what we can do to make sure that South Asians are really well represented at a school where we are a lot, but a lot of us remain hidden in a lot of main parts of campus.
Then our last question is, what do you think we can do as a school and community to make Asians feel more seen on campus?
I think just like supporting cultural orgs like Raisins, I feel like maybe like support, but also like collaboration between like cultural orgs and non like cultural orgs. Each space is too contained within their own like community at Middlebury. Maybe, I don't know, maybe it's on us that we don't want to steer away from like what we're comfortable with and the people we're comfortable with. But like if we want to be seen like within the community and not just within our own community, there has to be like a better way of collaborating or mixing different events together, or even just like getting people who are not in these cultural orgs to like come to like our, like some of our bigger events, you know? Like, yeah, some events should just be for us. This is like a space just for us and that should be kept like that. But we should find a way to not be like, I wouldn't want to use the word like segregated, but just like not so divided as like different communities within Middlebury.
Honestly, like I feel like these clubs are a great way of making Asian American students more seen on campus. Like, I think guest speakers, Asian Americans, would be really cool. I'd say like a week and a half ago, I went to this book conference for my Italian literature class, and the author was Asian American. It was like also really like interesting just like hearing her talk about her experiences as an Asian American that I felt like should be done more.
I think that South Asians tend to be removed from Asian discourse most of the time, if not always. Something that I'm really hoping and trying to do throughout my 4 years at Middlebury is to really bridge the gap between the Asian student organizations. You know, I think it would be nice for like SASA, which I'm part of, to do something with like the Korean culture community or to do some more things with Raisins. I know there's Asia at Mid. So that's something that I'm really trying to do, which is to make sure that the South Asian identity within the Asian spectrum is brought to the forefront.
It's really important to remember that the experiences of Asian people versus Asian American people versus like half Asian people are like totally different. And it's difficult to try to put them under this one label of just Asian. Different regions in Japan have different cultures and different dialects. And so even when we're talking about Japanese culture, you have to break it down. So you can only imagine like a tiny island versus this whole continent.
I don't know, I guess I don't see a lot of the shows, but I went to go see Somewhere, and it was really cool to see like two like Asian women playing roles. I feel like I never see that, like, especially like international students that have like an accent or something. Like, I feel like I never see them like in main roles like that, and it was just like really cool to see like, I don't know, two like powerful Asian women like playing a role. Like, I don't know, it's just like really interesting to see myself like on stage or something, or see someone that like looks like me like be in that like leading role that you normally like never see.
Out of the plays I've seen besides Somewhere, I think Maylee was like the only Asian rep. And I love Maylee. Like, mm-hmm. She is so good. Mm-hmm. I saw her in The Moors and she was like she was like the chicken. And I was like, okay, she killed it. Like, she slayed. Uh-huh. But like, why was she the chicken? Out of all the, like, the one POC was the chicken?
Yeah.
Come on, you guys.
Yeah, what's going on there?
I don't know.
I think my main thing is just thank you, right? Thank you for inviting me, asking questions, amplifying my voice and others. It's really special, and I love Raisins.
Thank you so much. That was amazing. That was great.
Thank you.
Do you have any last like comments or anything you want to add before your interview is finished?
Whoever came up with this idea, those two people, they must be like really cool.
No, don't be attacked, you're just beautiful. Don't jump on me.
Paparazzi.